Good morning and welcome to Christ Reformed Presbyterian Church this Lord's Day, June 6th, 2021. And we've got a pretty good turnout now relative to last week, so thank you. It's good to see you all here. It really is. We have announcements, and I'll give the major one, and anybody can correct me if any facts I give are not correct. We have worship at the ranch next Sunday, June 13th. And I believe we have always met at the Fort Laramie Bar that's not open, but out in front as the initial gathering spot. And then anybody who wants to jump in the vehicle with somebody else or whatever, we can make those arrangements. Someone that's there will know the way. And Lee reports that the road has been improved to the place where we do. It's a beautiful spot if you've ever been there. It's on what they call Cottonwood Creek, I think, and it's a beautiful spot. So we won't be meeting here on Sunday, therefore we won't have Sunday school. Meet at the Fort Laramie Saloon in the front of it at what time?
9 a.m.
At 9.
And it's carry-in lunch.
And it's carry-in lunch. So that we've accomplished this before, and it was wonderful. So whoever hears that, bring something, and then we'll have a communal meal and a worship service at the ranch.
And probably arrival window 8:30 to 9. I mean, you can sit and wait, talk to people if you want to ride, but I think we're leaving at 9.
Okay, so yeah. So get there between 8:30 and 9, and apparently we're going to depart Fort Laramie, the proper, and head to the ranch spot at 9.
And call me if you're running late and need some directions. We'll make sure that someone stands by to escort you.
Right, and it looks to me like the weather forecast is dry, so we shouldn't have muddy roads and that sort of thing. And it's been a wonderful experience for me, at least, and I think a lot of people have really enjoyed that. That's sort of an annual thing we've been doing, and thanks to Hugh and Lee for hosting that. So, all right, are there any other announcements? Grace. Yes, and it's a local Right to Life, right?
Yes.
There's a lady here, Becky knows her, that
is the,
yes, it is a good ministry, and they provide medical services for young women who are pregnant to help
and
them along.
The whole thing.
So yeah, wonderful ministry. So if you've got some extra giving, that's a wonderful ministry to give to. So anything else? Seeing nothing, I know Pastor Nate has a video he wants to play before, at this point in the order of worship.
So, in terms of cultural observations, if I were to be bold enough to put forth what ails the church, I would say that, and it's complicated, but in a very short version and one notation of history, Carl Rogers was an evangelical like you and me, and then he left it and he started a patient-centered psychotherapy. It's called Rogerian therapy. And he said that, like a chiropractor, man's soul will elevate to its perfected status if we provide an environment that's safe and trusting. That's all the therapist does. That's what his or her focus is on. And then the soul takes over in its own healing and self-actualization. That has been an enemy of the church, because we are encumbered with the neurotic sense of trying to find God in our lives because it's me-focused. His therapy was called client-focused therapy. And Christianity has ingested this. It's pew-focused therapy. Instead of us trying to find God in our lives, we operate on the basis of the church calendar. And what it says, not explicitly, but it invites you to find your story in God's story, not God's story in your story. And so there's a difference of emphasis there, and I just want you to see this little blurb on the church calendar here, and I thought it was helpful. So,
Christians are people who tell time differently. It's not as if they avoid clocks and calendars. No one escapes that. But from the beginning, they have engaged in a very different kind of rhythm, finding themselves in a world where time has been transformed into an instrument of God's revelation. In other words, Christians made their own calendar and relived the story of God throughout the year. Let me demonstrate. So the church calendar is divided into two halves. The first half starts in December with Advent, and it stretches all the way to Pentecost in May or June. And this part of the year tells the story of Jesus, from his birth to death, to resurrection and ascension. And the second half of the year starts at Pentecost and then goes all the way to Christ the King Sunday in late November. It tells the story of God's people, the church. For the next 6 months, the church follows this calendar and relives the story of Jesus. As any good story does, we'll start right at the beginning, chapter 1. This is where we observe the season of Advent and wait with expectation and prepare for the birth of Jesus. As chapter 1 ends, we move to chapter 2. This chapter brings news of great joy as we celebrate Jesus' birth and the feast of Christmas. We then turn the page to chapter 3. We remember the appearance of Jesus to the entire world, represented by the visiting magi from afar. The story begins its climax in chapter 4. This ushers in a solemn season of Lent, where, like Jesus' real desert, we spend 40 days in a metaphorical desert, pulling away from created comforts to make space for God. This chapter is long and difficult, but the joy of chapter 5 is worth the wait. Jesus' resurrection from the dead makes Easter Sunday the ultimate celebration, which then leads to the sixth and final chapter. Jesus' story concludes not only with his ascension into heaven, but with the coming of the Spirit, sent to create a new community, the church, to continue his work on earth. To listen to the church tell the story of the Lord is to listen to the Lord, the church. Reliving the first six chapters of the year not only shapes our worship, but it brings Christ into our very lives today. In Advent, Christmas, and Epiphany, it's as if we're with him in his birth and earthly ministry. In Lent, Easter, and Pentecost, we are again right by his side through death, burial, and resurrection. Living our faith through the lens of Jesus sanctifies our own lives. For his is an epic story. Darkness and light, grief and joy, struggle and rest. It mirrors the tensions and complexity of our own stories. And through it all, we're placed right in the middle of the great drama of God's redemption of the world. So you're invited to live the Christian year these next 6 months.
So, I've heard from non-liturgical people, they criticize churches that are liturgical. And they go, oh, outward form and repetition. The truth of the matter is, liturgical just means order. Every church has a liturgy. And when you walk into someone who's adamantly opposed to liturgy, they have their own liturgy. Someone may greet you at the door, you sit down, there's some few songs, you hear somebody preach, you have donuts and coffee, and out you go. So everyone has liturgy. The question is, what liturgy best suits the context in which we're reaching or attempting to reach the lost for Christ and edify God's people? And I would argue that the historical liturgy has this wonderful sense of worldwide communion. Throughout the whole world, these texts are being preached and examined and read, and the hymns are coordinated with them, and God's people sing. There's a church universal just in that aspect. But as we heard nicely laid out here, our lives can be found in the life of Christ and then the life of the Spirit in the church. And I think it's a wonderful thing, even though I criticize the liturgy from time to time, as you know. So just ponder that. In our illness, whether it be our health, whether it be the loss of a friend, whether it be a bad medical verdict, we should find whatever is going on in our life, we should find our story in His story, because every part of our lives is being redeemed in total, and it's found there. So anyway, I thought that was cool.
All right, thank you for that. Please rise and we'll sing our introit. All glory, laud, and honor. That's your songbook number 4. And I guess it's also on the screen.
It is in your songbook. The words are also on the screen. And so we'll sing with their layout.
Immortal men and all things created.
Now the votum. Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Who made heaven and earth.
And now for Pastor Nate's opening invocation.
Our Father, we thank you for the rhythm of worship. We thank you for the history of your church in worship throughout the centuries, indeed throughout the millennia. It is to you we want to focus on. It's not us. Oh, we are involved. We are found in your story to us, your story of redemption, culminating in the coming of your Son, Jesus the Christ. It's in that story that our story is found. And faith knows that. And faith will rest in that. And faith will cling to that. It isn't ultimately about us at all, then. It's about you. It's about the God who is there. It's about the God whose worship and adoration is due you. And then with Irenaeus, we can say the glory of God is man fully alive when we find our story in yours. May that be the case during this hour of worship, Lord. May we be found in what we hear, in what we sing, in what we read. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
And now for our confession and declaration, our confession of sin. Let us proclaim the mystery of our faith. Christ has died.
We have died.
Christ has risen.
We have risen.
Let us therefore confess our sins as we worship our risen Lord.
Heavenly Father, your Son's work of redemption is finished.
While our flesh with its desires has been crucified with Christ, making us truly justified, we are yet encumbered with the residue of sin. We desire, yet we push back. We hope, yet there is grief and sadness. We possess, yet not fully. It is this waiting, this not yet, that in part causes our hearts to be heavy. In ways that we cannot fully understand, we sin because we are yet sinners. Forgive us, O Lord, and renew us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name.
And we'll take a time for silent reflection and confession. And now, brothers and sisters, for his declaration of grace. It's my privilege to declare this. It is Christ's declaration, not mine. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, we have confessed together that we are not what we should be. We are sinners. His law justly weighs in, making our conscience feel its transgression. Nevertheless, grace and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ reign supreme. For the joy of gathering his people and in our place, Christ has both fulfilled the law and borne the fury of a just and holy wrath. Our guilt is gone. He has also bound the strong man, freeing us from his bondage. Therefore, with joyous shouts of hallelujah, I declare to you God's work through Christ alone, the forgiveness of sins. For our call to praise today, it comes from Psalm 138. I give you thanks, O Lord, with my whole heart. Before the gods, I sing your praise.
I bow down toward your holy temple and give thanks to your name for your steadfast love and your faithfulness. For you have exalted above all things your name and your word.
On the day I called, you answered me. My strength of soul you increased.
All the kings of the earth shall give you thanks, O Lord, for they have heard the words of your mouth.
And they shall sing of the ways of the Lord, for great is the glory of the Lord.
For though the Lord is high, he regards the lowly, but the haughty he knows from afar.
Though I walk in the midst of trouble, you preserve my life. You stretch out your hand against the wrath of my enemies, and your right hand delivers me.
The Lord will fulfill his purpose for me. Your steadfast love, O Lord, endures forever. Do not forsake the work of your hands.
Thank you. And now for our scripture reading. Whoever does not know the scriptures does not know the power of God, nor his wisdom. Ignoring the scriptures means ignoring Christ. And as Martin Luther said, whoever wants to hear God speak should read Holy Scripture.
First reading comes from 1 Samuel chapter 8, verses 1 through 11. When Samuel became old, he made his sons judges over Israel. The name of his firstborn son was Joel, and the name of his second, Abijah. They were judges in Beersheba. Yet his sons did not walk in his ways, but turned aside after gain. They took bribes and perverted justice. Then all the elders of Israel gathered together and came to Samuel in Ramah and said to him, "Behold, you are old and your sons do not walk in your ways. Now appoint for us a king to judge us like all the nations." But the king displeased Samuel when they said, "Give us a king to judge us." And Samuel prayed to the Lord. And the Lord said to Samuel, "Obey the voice of the people in all that they say to you, for they have not rejected you, but they have rejected me from being king over them. According to all the deeds that they have done, from the day I brought them up out of Egypt, even to this day, forsaking me and serving other gods, so they are also doing to you. Now then, obey their voice, only you shall solemnly warn them and show them the ways of the king who shall reign over them." So Samuel told all the words of the Lord to the people who were asking for a king from him. He said, "These will be the ways of the king who will reign over you. He will take your sons and appoint them to his chariots, and to be his horsemen, and to run before his chariots." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading this morning is 2 Corinthians 4:7 through 5:1. But we have this treasure in jars of clay, to show that the surpassing power belongs to God and not to us. We are afflicted in every way, but not crushed, perplexed, but not driven to despair, persecuted, but not forsaken, struck down, but not destroyed, always carrying in the body of the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be manifested in our bodies. For we who live are always being given over to death for Jesus' sake, so that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our mortal flesh. So death is at work in us, but life in you. Since we have the same spirit of faith according to what has been written, "I believed, and so I spoke," we also believe, and so we also speak, knowing that he who raised the Lord Jesus will raise us also with Jesus and bring us with you into the presence. For it is all for your sake, so that as grace extends to more and more people, it may increase thanksgiving to the glory of God. So we do not lose heart, though our outer self is wasting away, our inner self is being renewed day by day. For this light momentary affliction is preparing us for an eternal weight of glory beyond all comprehension, or beyond all comparison, as we look not to the things that are seen, but to the things that are unseen. For the things that are seen are transient, but the things that are unseen are eternal. For we know that if the tent that is our earthly home is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You have an insert in your bulletin because I did not get the gospel reading changed and didn't notice it until after I printed the bulletins. So the loose insert is the reading that we're going to be looking at. It's Mark chapter 3, verses 20 through 35. If you don't have an insert, there's some on the podium on the south side as you enter. Then we went home, and the crowd gathered again, so that they could not even eat. And when his family heard it, they went out to seize him. For they were saying, "He is out of his mind." And the scribes who came down from Jerusalem were saying, "He is possessed by Beelzebub, and by the prince of demons he casts out the demons." And he called them to him and said to them in parables, "How can Satan cast out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, the kingdom cannot stand. And if a house is divided against itself, that house will not be able to stand. And if Satan has risen up against himself and is divided, he cannot stand, but is coming to an end. But no one can enter a strong man's house and plunder his goods unless he first binds the strong man. Then indeed he may plunder his house. Truly I say to you, all sins will be given the children of man, and whatever blasphemies they utter. But whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit never has forgiveness, but is guilty of an eternal sin. For they were saying, he has an unclean spirit. And his mothers and his brothers came, and standing outside, they sent to him and called him. And a crowd was sitting around him, and they said to him, your mother and your brothers are outside seeking you. And he answered them, who are my mother and my brothers? And looking about at those who sat around him, he said, here are my mother and my brothers. For whoever does the will of God, he is my brother and sister and mother. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And now I direct your eyes to the screen as we sing, "'Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus." "'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word,
just to rest upon his promise, just to know the saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I prove him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus,
Our Father, I pray that you will be in our speaking and in our hearing and in our hearts' meditations. We ask in Jesus' name, amen. So the title of this message is, Who is Your King? And that's a biblical question. It is it's not a one-time question and a one-time answer. Luther, as I've said time and time again, described the Christian life as a daily repentance and renewal. But what is repentance? It's broken sinners bowing before the God who was there, confessing their tyranny, confessing their rebellion, and asking to have mercy upon them and renew them so that they might follow him in his rule and reign. That's what repentance is. It's a creature coming to the Creator. And so we find that in our call to praise briefly. If you want to turn to there, you may. It starts out with, I give you thanks, O Lord, with my whole heart. That's what a creature does. That's what we are designed to do. That's what feels right. That's what connects. That's what common sense and intuition says, ah, yes, this is where life is. Is found, rendering thanks to the God who is there. I bow towards your holy temple in verse 2. Why? To give thanks again to your name. And the name means something. Again, it's not magical, it's the steadfast love and faithfulness found in the God who is there. You have exalted above all things your name and your word. His name, of course, is intimately bound up with the steadfast love and his faithfulness. And in your name and in your word, the Torah, the word of God, sometimes the entire Old Testament, sometimes the five books of Moses, but it's the Torah, it's the Word. And then when the time was right, the living Word came to earth and turned it upside down. God's Son came. The living Word came. Verse 4, all the kings of the earth shall give you thanks, O Lord, for they have heard the words of your mouth. Now that shall is, I think, composed of a couple things. There's a certainty, and there's a future aspect to this. Now, on the eschatological realm, the post-millennialists believe that the gospel that we preach is going to change the world and restore the kingdom, and the kings are all going to worship God as they should. And when that universal reign is demonstrated and internalized here on earth, Christ comes back. The Amil, which is very much a part of our tradition as well, says that that's not going to happen until Christ comes back. Now, Paul was rejoicing that some in the Praetorian Guards gave their life to Christ, repented. Paul would have given thanks if Nero had bowed his knee and had given thanks. But I believe that history is going to be checkered and lack that fulfillment ultimately until Jesus Christ comes back. But both are in our tradition, and both can find a place in our text. Luther, that Herb read, whoever wants to hear God speak should read Holy Scripture. So there's a living word that visited earth and turned it upside down, and the New Testament is the description of that momentous living word that came. And so Luther is saying, you want to know who God is? Read the text. Read about him. Read about what he has done. Read about who he is. Okay. Now, on the reading that Susan read to us in 2 Corinthians, Paul is very clear that the life in Christ is relevant for this day and age. In verse 8, afflicted, not crushed, perplexed, not driven to despair, persecuted, not forsaken, struck down, but not destroyed, always carrying in the body the death of Christ, so death, verse 12, is at work in us, but life in you. The mark of the apostolic ministry was sacrifice on behalf of others so that they might know and grow in Christ. Verse 13 is very interesting. Since we have the same spirit of faith according to what has been written, I believed and so spoke. Now that's interesting. I believed and so spoke. There's something about believing that I said earlier, if the Spirit regenerates our hearts, we sense, we intuit that we are home, that we are before our King, our Master, our Lord, our friend, our brother. It all makes sense. Experientially, intuitively, mentally, it has a glue that holds things together. And in believing, we therefore speak. Apologetics is not an apology for being Christian, but it is a defense of the faith. But as Calvin said, and I agree with him, and I believe Luther too, if you are trying to build a case for God, for Christianity, simply on the basis of reason, it won't happen unless the Spirit regenerates that self, that I, that intuitive center, because it will never happen. We are rebellious creatures, we are at enmity with God, and we will not submit to his rule and reign, no matter how much evidence is put forth. Now some say, well, we put forth those arguments anyway because God uses them. I think he does, but let's not put too much weight in them. Verse 16, and then we'll jump to our text. So we do not lose heart, though our outer self is wasting away, our inner self is being renewed day by day. Now, some people say Christianity is platonic. It's just all about angels and heaven, and we're just floating spirits. And you see, it says here, our outer self is wasting away, and we're going to be released from our bodies so that we can enjoy. But even now, the inner man is being transformed, and then when we get rid of our body, we'll be in heaven floating spirits. And that's simply not biblical. That's not what the New Testament teaches. Paul is saying this, that our outer self, our bodies, are wasting away. They are not participating in the future, which is a redeemed body, an immortal body. These bodies are not in any way participating in that redemption, but our inner selves are. And so the work of God in this world remains hidden in that sense. God's work inwardly is happening in God's people. There are transformational realities day by day, but the body is just like an unbeliever. And so God's rule and reign in that sense remains hidden until Jesus comes back again. And in the twinkling of an eye, Bonnie will get a new body. And all the rest of you. Thank God, but not now. Okay, now to the question, who is your king? Let's look at 1 Samuel. chapter 8, where God's people demand a king. Now, their concern is legitimate. Samuel had appointed his sons to be judges over Israel. At the time, there's no king in Israel. Never has been a king in Israel, a human king. So their concern is correct. Their firstborn, Joel and Abijah, were judges, yet they didn't walk in the ways of the Lord. They turned aside after personal gain. They took bribes and perverted justice. Samuel's old. He's on his way out. The concern is legitimate, and they're nervous. But they come not inquiring with the prophet of God. Now, there's been prophets. Samuel is the beginning of the official office of prophet, but Moses, Scripture says, is the greatest prophet. But here the ministry of prophet is embedded in the life of Samuel. And they were judges as well, and there were priests. But there were no kings, no human kings. God's people say in verse 5b, appoint for us a king to judge us like the nations, like all the nations. Now, in that sentence, we find the heart's error. And we know there's an error in it, not because we can read behind the words, but because God says to Samuel, after being displeased, the Lord said, obey the voice of the people, in verse 7, in all that they say to you, for they have not rejected you, but they have rejected me from being king over them. These are the same people, mind you, that lost a battle because they were not trusting in God. And then they went to get the Ark of the Covenant, thinking it had a magical potency, and they brought it into battle, and they lost terribly. These are the same people, the same ones who lacked faith to trust and obey. And now they demand a king. In verse 5b, now appoint for us a king. In 6b, give us a king. You see, they came to the prophet of God insisting on a king like the other nations who can judge them and go into battle for them and on their behalf. A complete lack of faith and trust in the God who is there. It was a demand. Now, what was the prophet? You see, the prophet had a living word from God. That's what the prophets are marked by. And God's people went to the prophets to learn what to do, to learn what to do in a specific context. And they had some miraculous things called the Urim and Thummim. And we don't really know what it was, but it was placed in the ephod. And we don't really know what that was, but it seemed to have shoulder straps with the 12 names of Israel on them, and then an ephod laced in all kinds of intricate prized jewels and yarn. And in there was a pocket of the Urim and Thummim. And God's people would come to the prophet or the priest and grab, supposedly, this Urim and Thummim, and they would see what the Lord's will was in a given context. It's a mysterious thing. But you see, God's people didn't want to do that anymore. They didn't want to hear living words from God. They saw the nations. They were led by kings into battle. And we want that security. We want that power. God says, do what they say. They haven't rejected you. They have rejected me. Another reason why we know that this is sin is in chapter 12, verse 12, we find this. Well, let's go to Judges first, chapter 8, verse 22. And we'll see where the error of the heart was. This is Gideon's ephod. Then the men of Israel said to Gideon, "Rule over us, you and your sons and your grandson also, for you have saved us from the hand of Midian." Now this is prior to. Okay? And someone steps in, defeats their enemies, and immediately they gravitate toward this human figure, and they want him as a king. They want him to do that again and again and again, and they want it guaranteed. They want the peace and security of the Canaanites. Gideon responds in verse 23, "I will not rule over you, and my son will not rule over you. The Lord will rule over you." You see, without a human king, Israel was a purer theocratic nation. The reign and rule of God was, God was king. And they came to the prophet to hear from their king. But it wasn't secure. There could be no fleshly reliance on outward forms. They saw that when they tried to do the magical ark thing in battle, and it failed miserably. They want, human nature wants something to trust. That's secure, that's solid, that doesn't change, but in which they do not have to submit to the true and living God who is there. Thus, Calvin says the human heart is an idolatry factory. That's what it is, essentially. That's why Coram Hominibus, there's great, nice people doing great civil things, great, wonderful philanthropists who are helping us exist and progress and to eliminate suffering. But in their heart, they will not have God to rule and reign over them. But that's not manifested. It can be hidden. Just like our redemption of our bodies and our redemption is hidden in failing bodies, so unbelievers' rebellion against God is hidden in their righteousness. Now take that, put that in your pipe and smoke it and chew on that for a while. Human rebellion is hidden in human righteousness. Saintly righteousness is hidden in our failing sinful bodies. So, that's the problem. The heart will not, cannot submit to the king who's to rule over them. And we see this and we think, oh, those Jews. And this is where this Jewish mentality has come from in part, to a large part. They want to blame the world for their things. Hitler tried it. You see, even their own text blames them. But you see, the history of Israel is the history of humanity. That's what Romans 1 through 3 teaches us. Israel isn't uniquely unrighteous. Israel isn't uniquely untrusting. Israel isn't uniquely dependent on everything and anything and trying to find something other than the God who is there. Israel's not unique in that sense. Israel's history is your history. Israel's history is my history. Israel's history lives in and under my spiritual fight in my breast as I seek to serve God. You see, they're not uniquely evil. There's some outward circumstances where we sometimes crassly go, man, Israel was really stupid. Israel was really obstinate, weren't they? But those are external shadows of an internal reality and a glimpse into the every human heart that has ever walked the face of this earth. And we are in dire need of regeneration. It's a miracle, and without it, we perish. Now, interesting, the prophet Samuel told the words to the Lord, told all the words of the Lord to the people who were asking for a king. Samuel says in verse 11, these will be the ways of the king who will reign over you. He will take your sons and appoint them to his chariots and to be his horsemen and to run before his chariots. That's going to be your future. Your human king that you so desperately want, it's going to be a burden. It's going to be a curse in a sense. And yet in that curse comes the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords in the Son of God himself. Now, back to that little blurb on the Jewish people in verse 8. According to all the deeds that they have done from the day that I brought them out of Egypt, even to this day, forsaking me and serving other gods, so they are also doing to you. This is the story of the human heart, bar none. You think they were obstinate. God is merely speaking about you, about me. And so, brothers and sisters, who is your king? You know, earlier I started out by saying, find your story in his story. It seems like the title of this sermon is to start with you. Who is your king? But you see, Scripture doesn't allow such simplistic renderings. Paul will say, I am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I committed to him against that day of universal judgment in which the hearts of all are opened like a book and everything is exposed. Yet Paul's confidence was clear, and he could speak of what he committed to the true and living God. In our tradition, if there's any out of balance, it's the sovereignty of God. Oh, God does everything. God does everything. Nothing comes from us. And ultimately, that's true. But from that sovereign will of God is this mystery in which we are enveloped in the grace of God. And we're called upon to believe. We're called upon to trust. We're called upon to commit. There's a book by one of the Puritans called The I Do of the Psalms. Man, the will is engaged in our sanctification most clearly, and we see it in Psalms. It just reverberates throughout the Psalms. I will, I will, I will, I will, I will, I will, which is the mark of the regenerate heart. No, brothers and sisters, there's a profound mystery in the divine human relationship. But make no mistake, the commands are clear. The will is commanded. It's commanded to act. It's commanded to believe. It's commanded to have affect of delighting in God himself. I pray that you will ask yourself, who is my king? And I pray that in asking, you will then fall on your knees and ask for God to forgive you of your failings. And ask God, get this now, to renew you so that you may delight in his will and walk in his ways to the glory of his holy name. Amen. And now let's confess our faith in the Apostles' Creed found in the beginning of your songbook. I believe in God the Father, prayers of God's people as we call upon him. Oh, the victory is sure. It is certain. But God's means of bringing about that kingdom is through his people. So come to him. Ask of him. Call upon him. Father, I pray that you will hear the prayers of your people. I pray that you will comfort them if there are cries within their heart that they do not want to share. Indeed, cannot share because they don't even know what's troubling them. May your spirit, Lord, groan with groanings that we can't utter. And thereby, Lord, continue to transform your people into that new creation, into that beautiful creation that you have designed from all eternity. Now hear your people, cover our requests and mercy in Jesus' name.
Told about you and your saving grace. Lord, I pray that if they not yet be regenerate, that you grant them saving grace. I pray that you will discipline them to the degree that you know is good for them and necessary for them in order to bring them back to the fold. I pray for continued faithfulness in this congregation. I pray for continued faithfulness in the deacons and in the elders and in the pastor and the pastor's family. Continue to bless us with that faithfulness, Lord. Please guide us in ways to reach out to those in this community who need you, and there are so many of them. Lord, we're so bound up in our abundance of wealth and our distractions, all our pleasures, that we leave no room for you. And Lord, it's just the irony of existence that the more wealth we get, the less we depend on you. It's just the history of things. Lord, sometimes it takes you to take everything away in order to focus people on what truly needs to be focused on, which is Jesus Christ. Lord, we appoint people to lead us at all levels, whether they be parents of children, school teachers, school administrators, policemen, firemen, county commissioners, city councilmen, mayors, county commissioners, legislators, governors, judges. We appoint all those people over us, Lord. And you call us to pray for them so that we may live lives of peace in the society in which we find ourselves. So, Lord, I do pray for them. And Lord, I pray that you will open their eyes, especially to the notion, which is true, that they have their authority because you grant it, whether they recognize that or not, and that they are going to be eternally accountable for how they exercise that authority. Open their eyes up to that authority. And it's come a time where there are just wicked men in this world, wicked men with billions of dollars that affect all the whole world, including this United States, with all their nefarious plots and plans, or to develop their global government and whatever they think that they're smart enough to run and order us all around and under. Lord, I pray that you expose them for who they are, and I pray that you tear them down and just thwart their nefarious plots and plans. Lord, I pray that you continue to bless us to come out of this pandemic. Lord, I also pray that you'll open our eyes to the lessons we should have learned, Lord, and how we need to make people accountable for all the things that were done to us, and what we allowed to be done to us during that, so that it doesn't happen again. I just leave all these things to you, Lord, and ultimately I pray that you do that which only you can do, Lord. Only you can open eyes and unplug ears and change hearts of stone to hearts of flesh. Only you can do that. And I humbly ask that you do that. In Jesus' name, amen.
Lord God, I pray for Life Choice Pregnancy Care Center. I pray that many will be moved to support that through this fundraiser that Grace has brought to our attention today. Please bless those people in their work, as well as those in other such organizations like Pro-Life Across America. Lord, it is an awful, awful reflection upon this country that babies are being sacrificed. And this is just not acceptable to us as Christians. And yet, some people are content to do nothing. I pray for protection for those who are out there on the front lines doing something, and I pray that they will receive the monetary and prayer support that they need to save the babies.
God, I would pray that you would continue to be with Matthew as he much for encouraging him and being with him to enjoy his adventurous life.
And now, if you would, join with me in praying the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom,
the power and the glory forever. Amen. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give Him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary, evermore praising you and singing,
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on all. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Grant us peace.
On the night that our Lord was forsaken, and on the Passover night, he took the bread and he broke it. And he said, "This is my body given for you. Take and eat." In the same way, when he had given thanks, he took the cup of blessing and he poured the fruit of the vine, saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant, my blood shed for you for the remission of sins. This drink of it, all of you, in remembrance of me." Blood of Christ shed for you.
Body of Christ given for you.
Thank you.
And the blood of Christ shed for you. Come and receive God's living word through his word to you. The blood of Christ shed for you. The blood of Christ shed for you.
The blood of Christ given for you.
The blood of Christ shed for you.
Body of Christ given for you.
The blood of Christ shed for you.
blood of Christ shed for you.
Body of Christ given for you.
The blood of Christ shed for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. The blood of Christ shed for you.
Body of Christ given for you.
The blood of Christ shed for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. Did he come up? The blood of Christ shed for you. The body and blood of Christ given for you, Herb.
Body and blood of Christ given for you and shed for you. Amen, brother.
Amen. Let's stand together and sing our exiting hymn.
Lord, Lord, blessing our true faith confessing.
For God's benediction, we were not able to get to it, but the second to the last page, there is a triangle of Yahweh, Israel, and land, because a theocracy is just that. The living God has a nation called his people, and he has given them a land, and that was the promised land. And Israel was tired of her unique status. Israel was tired of inquiring through the living word of the prophet and judge just what God would have them to do. And so, in summary, one theologian summed up their request for a king this way. It was sinful in its motive. It was selfish in its timing. It was cowardly in its spirit. sinful in its motive, selfish in its timing, cowardly in its spirit. So what are we to do? Are you tired of your unique status in Jesus Christ? 97% of the people of American culture said, I don't care who I marry. Their faith makes no difference to me. I'm an all-inclusive American. Are you tired of your status as a single person? God directs us to marry believers because God wants a unifying marriage testifying of His grace. We tire sometimes of our status, even as New Covenant believers. But I will end with this. We start off confessing our sins, and then we say our guilt is gone, but He has also bound the strong man, freeing us from his bondage. And we saw that in our Markian text. Jesus denied that he was casting out demons by Beelzebub. Satan cannot cast himself out. But no one can enter a strong man's house and plunder his goods unless he first binds the strong man. And in our prayer every week, we say that he has bound the strong man. He has freed us in Christ to do what he has called us to be and become. So go in the power of Christ's binding of the evil one in your house. You are free in Christ. Enjoy that freedom. Thank you for coming.